all of the youth should not be undermined or sidelined. It's important that you just highlight it. You say, you know, the policies say they want to involve the youth, but where are the youth? They are behind bars for expressing freedom of expression and articulating their needs. So it's actually an important segue, because now I'm going to turn to Professor Lloyd. And all states usually have a vision. There's a national vision that guides states where they want to go, what is their development policy and vision of where they want to go in 10 years, 15 years, 100 years. So I'm sure Zimbabwe definitely had one during the liberation struggle, before and after. So my question to you is, what happened to that national vision of wanting a democratic developmental state? What went wrong? And looking at the stakeholders in the room today, what can we actually do?
Thank you, Madam Chair, for that very important question. But I think I will also begin by restating my own accolades for the book. I think it's a significant and timely contribution as a book to the concept of the developmental and democratic state, the DDS. I think the book does very well in refining the term, the concept, but also applying it to living country case studies in this region, including Zimbabwe, as we had from Dr. Chipika, but also South Africa, Namibia, Botswana, Malawi, and a couple of others. I think what this debate helps us to do is to be able to set out the context or the conjuncture, and I'll spend 1 or 2 minutes on that, because I think it's important to lay out the context and the conjuncture. I think what the book does is to come at a stage in which the debate about the state has been going on for some time. But I think it's quite clear now that the idea of a minimalist state, the argument of rolling back the state, I think that has been now quite clearly discredited. We know that the World Bank, the IMF, the neoliberal orthodox was for that. And I think these studies, including this book, have really shown how outdated that kind of concept of the state is out of date. But I think the book follows, I think, a recent pattern in Africa regarding the debate on the developmental state. It joins contributions by Dr. Ebigeji, I think, quite extensively, and included contributions from leading African scholars such as Kandawire, but also contributions on a national level by Dr. Molutsi Sabutuguru in Botswana, and I think Gumede also in South Africa. So we really see here a body of knowledge that is growing, to which this book isn't an important addition. And I think it comes in also in the context of this Africa Rising discourse, which, despite the slowdown, the commodity slowdown in the last few years, I think is still an important narrative in Africa. And more widely, also comes in this wider BRICS debate, in which you also have, in fact, interesting models of the developmental state. You have China there representing an authoritarian model of developmental state, and India representing a democratic, if you like, model of a developmental state. So the appearance of the book, I think, is an addition to this important context. And I think, as I said, the important case studies that we that are contained in the book, particularly Botswana, but also reference Mauritius, Namibia, and further afield countries like Ghana. I think these are all experimental cases of countries that are trying to bring about development in a democratic direction. But at the same time also reminding us that there are pitfalls of captured state capture in this. And I think the reference to South Africa and Angola are important references that have been made. I won't touch much on the Zimbabwe case because we've had very, I think, learned analysis of what has gone right and where the limitations have been. But clearly, we see that there are challenges and potentials, but quite clearly, the tension between redistribution and sustained growth, the need to have that balance right. I think it's an ongoing process, but I think it's important. It's important to bear in mind the need to grapple with that. But I think Zimma Asset, of course, has one of its objectives as the creation of a democratic development state. It might be buried somewhere there in the document, but it's an aspiration. It's a kind of a vision, national vision, that this country does have. But of course, issues of corruption and risks of the captured state, or the predatory state, as the title of the thesis, PhD thesis of my brother here, is all about. I think it shows us, you know, some of the problems, you know, that do exist. But I think really, in conclusion, the broad question is, how do the state and the society become simultaneously democratic and developmental at the same time? The East Asia model is one in which you have authoritarianism and then democracy later. And what we're saying is that in the contemporary context in Africa, is it not possible to have both at the same time? And really, my sort of final observation or argument would be that there is no single model or one size fits all approach when it comes to building a democratic and developmental state. Nor is it possible to transplant a model that has been nurtured in a different context, in a different continent, in a different historical context, onto your own. And so I think this speaks to the question of the need for innovativeness, the need to have a problem-solving approach, the need to try to find those elements that are crucial. You can borrow aspects, but I think, you know, the entire model that you're building will have, should have ingredients, local and national ingredients in it. Because even now, if we look at East Asia, which has done very well in terms of development, South Korea itself, I think it has been going through problems lately, governance problems. Old president, you know, had to forced to resign. We now have one of the leading leader of that company in jail because of corruption. In other words, the dangers of a captured state or state capture also do exist, even in democratic developmental states. So, the need for vigilance, I think, eternal vigilance on the part of citizens. It's important to have a state that is developmental and democratic, but the citizens should always, you know, call that state to account. And so So finally, I think the book, as I said, really stimulates us issues of enclavity, quality of growth, issues of natural resources extraction, redistribution, and its implications.
For these and other stories, visit our website www.263chat.com. Follow us on Twitter @263chat and like our Facebook page, 263chat.